Yesterday we considered yet another type of biasing the MOS transistor at a given current, that is based on source feedback. Okay, you connect a current source to the source of the MOS transistor and the drain current of the MOS transistor will become equal to the current, and this is because the source voltage also controls the drain current. So when you make that connection between the, when you connect the current source to the source of the transistor, the feedback will make sure that the source voltage gets adjusted itself to the desired value. Okay, so if this is I naught, then, and let's say the gate is at some fixed voltage VG0, then this voltage adjusts itself until the current in the transistor is I naught. Okay. And this kind of biasing, it turns out, is quite popular in discrete circuits, okay, especially with bipolar transistors, and also you can use it with MOS transistors. How do we turn it into a common source amplifier? First, we derive the gate bias. From the supply voltage, then we AC couple the input signal through the capacitor C1, okay, and we don't short the drain to a small signal ground, but have a bias resistor RD and AC couple the load as well. And finally, the source of the MOS transistor has to be at small signal ground, because the input signal has to get applied between the gate and source. Okay. And to do that, we connect a third capacitor C3 from the source terminal to ground. Okay. And each of these capacitors is expected to act like a short circuit at the signal frequency. Now, how do you make sure of that? You evaluate the resistance that appears across the capacitor in the source free circuit and make sure that the reactance of the capacitor at the signal frequency is much smaller than that resistance. Okay. This we have done many times before, and for C1 and C2, we have calculated it in the same form. C1 has to be much greater than 1 over omega times RS plus R1 parallel R2, and C2 it's RD plus RL. And we also know that if we want the drain voltage to be exactly the same as the load voltage, C2 has to be much greater than 1 over omega RL. Okay. And we were evaluating the constraint on capacitor C3. It has to be much greater than what? What's that? Gm by omega. So again, all we have to do is to evaluate the small signal resistance that appears across C3. How do we do that? First of all, Vi is set to 0. So that means that this is a short circuit, and the other capacitors are assumed to be chosen so that they are already short circuits. So it's like that. And we have to find the resistance that appears across the terminals of the capacitor, that is between this point and ground. How do you do that? How do you find the resistance between any two terminals in a circuit? What do you do? What's that? Yeah, you apply a voltage and find the resulting current, or apply a current and find the resulting voltage. This is of course in small signal, so that means that this I naught is an open circuit and the supply voltage is a short circuit. Okay. And the transistor has to be replaced with its incremental equivalent. So if you are getting confused by these things, Just do it component by component, terminal by terminal. This is the gate, this is the drain, this is the source. This source is GM times VGS, where VGS is this voltage. Okay. Now, because this is also ground, you can kind of fold the picture and show it falling down, but it's the same. Okay. So, now all you have to do is find the current that is flowing there. Let me call it I-test. Then the looking in resistance is V-test divided by I-test. Okay. And there is not much to determine here. Okay. What is this voltage at the gate? Minus at the gate. Why? Yeah. So at the gate it is zero. Okay. In fact, in order not to confuse, so let me also draw it in parallel here. So this will be R2 parallel R1 and this will be RL parallel RD. Okay. It must be pretty obvious that this voltage here is zero. It just has resistors connected to ground. And the voltage at the source is nothing but the applied voltage V-test. So this VGS is minus V-test. Okay. Zero minus V-test. So this incremental current here, it is minus GM times V-test flowing downwards or GM times V-test flowing upwards. Okay. So this current source here, GM times V-test flowing upwards. Okay. And you can also see that the current from the voltage source has only this one component, there is nothing else connected. So I-test equals that one. Okay. So V-test by I-test would be what? I-test is GM V-test, so V-test by I-test is 1 by GM. You can see that in case of the transistor, for different cases, you do get this incremental resistance of 1 by GM. When we had the diode connected transistor, when we connected the drain to gate, we had the same thing, right? The incremental resistance offered between the terminals was 1 by GM. Similarly, if you hold the gate at a fixed voltage, that is incrementally the gate is connected to ground, and you look into the source, the resistance that you see is 1 by GM. Okay. So that's the resistance that appears across C3, and we want the reactance of the capacitor C3 to be much smaller than the resistance that appears across it, or in other words, C3 has to be much more than GM by omega. Okay. So that's what we got here. Which of these three is likely to be the biggest capacitor? See? C3, C1, why is C3? Yeah, it's GM as opposed to the other conductances. Okay. So GM will be higher than the other conductances because obviously it is providing gain. Okay. So you connect a large enough capacitor here, or if you want to think about it differently. So let's say, let's just take some numbers. This is 24 volts, 4 mega ohm, 20 mega ohm. What is the voltage at the gate? What's the voltage at the gate? 4 volts. Let's say this is 200 microamperes. What is the voltage at the source? How much? 1. The gate source voltage for I didn't put down the transistor parameters, but the usual one I've been using, 100 microampere per volt square of current factor and a threshold voltage of 1 volt. Okay. And so let's say this is 100 kilo ohms, then this is also at 4 volts and this may be 100 kilo ohms and so on. So when you turn on the circuit, this C3 gets charged to 1 volt, this gets charged to 4 volts and this also gets charged to 4 volts. And if you apply a sinusoidal signal, as the sinusoid rises and falls, the voltages across these capacitors also rise and fall, but negligibly if you choose them following this criterion. Okay. The incremental voltages across the capacitors will be very small, or the capacitor voltage can be thought of as constant, roughly speaking. Okay, so they act like floating batteries which add or subtract voltages. Okay, because here we have Vi, and at this point we have approximately 4 volts plus Vi. I'll assume that RS is 0. And similarly, what will be the voltage here, the total voltage here? The operating point voltage is 4 volts. What is the gain with these resistor values? What is the gain of the common source amplifier? Let's assume that RS is 0. What is it? What is the gain? What is the expression for the gain? Then what is the value? Please calculate. Minus 10, yeah. So the gain is minus 10. So what is the drain voltage? What will be the drain voltage? Voltage of the drain? Total voltage at the drain. How do you find the total voltage? Yeah, add the operating point to increment. So what's the result? 4 volts minus 10 Vi. And what is the total voltage at the source? Why 4 plus Vi? The source terminal. What is it? It's 1 volt, that's all. There is no signal component, right? Because the whole point of having a large C3 was that the source is at ground, small signal ground. So that means there is no signal present at the source terminal, okay? So I assume that the capacitors are chosen to be short circuits. So the source will remain at 1 volt even after you apply the signal. The gate will have 4 volts plus Vi, that is Vi will get impressed on this 4 volt of bias, and the drain will have 4 volts minus 10 Vi, that is the output voltage, the amplified input voltage will be impressed on top of the operating point of 4 volts. And this capacitor C2 here, it has 4 volts across it. So the voltage across RL will of course be, what is it? What is the voltage across RL? What is that? Minus 10 Vi, okay. So that's how it works. The capacitors hold the operating point voltages, and similarly if you had inductors, they would hold the operating point currents and act like current sources, right? For as long as you have only sinusoidal signals. Okay. Any questions about this? This is the common source amplifier with source feedback bias. Okay. Any questions about any of the common source amplifiers we have discussed, with drain feedback, using current mirror, or with source feedback? Now we can try out the other two types of biasing. What is left? We tried sensing at the drain and feeding back to the gate, and sensing at the source and feeding back to the source. What else is left? What? Sensing at the drain and? What is the damage? Feeding back to source, yeah. So let's try that. So I have a current source I naught, and I have my MOS transistor with drain, gate, and source terminals. Okay. So what should I do to sense the difference at the drain? What is that? So, if I connect the current source like this, let's say this is the supply voltage. I mean, it can be anything. I can take that as zero, and then all other voltages will be negative. I'll take this as the supply voltage. Gate I'm not using. I'm feeding back to the source, so I'll connect this to some fixed voltage VG0. Okay? And then I have to essentially feed back to the source. Let me call that Vs. Okay. If I naught is more than ID, that is the actual drain current is smaller than the desired drain current, what should I do to Vs? Decrease. Yeah, we have to increase. This means that Vs must be decreased. Okay. Then what is happening as a result of the comparison? Let's imagine some parasitic capacitor here. I naught minus ID flows there. So if I naught is more than ID, what happens to the drain voltage? It will. What happens? It'll increase. Yeah. Okay. So what do we need to complete the feedback? We have to observe what's happening at the drain. That's where we are sensing the difference, and we have to control the source. That's where we are applying the feedback to. So we know what we need at the source. If I naught is more than ID, we have to reduce the source voltage, and we know what's happening at the drain. The drain voltage is actually increasing. So how do we complete the feedback loop? What should we do? What is that? Yeah, that's why we need feedback, right? If I naught is more than ID and we don't do anything, VD will go on increasing. So we have to observe that condition and reduce Vs. So what do we need? I mean, we have considered this before, right, in other cases of feedback. What kind of block do we need between the drain and source? Obviously, we have to take the drain as input and source as output, right, for the feedback, to complete the feedback. So what property should it have? Yeah, we need some negative gain, because as Vd increases, Vs must decrease. Okay, so that's all that's there to it. We need to have whatever block we have, it must have a negative incremental gain. Okay. That's fine. Now, of course, depending on the exact implementation of this, you also have to check whether the transistor remains in saturation region. Okay. So because the drain voltage increases if I naught is more than ID and the source voltage must reduce, we have to have a negative incremental gain between the drain and source, okay. And what can, I mean, how could I complete this feedback loop? Let's say you are familiar with op amps, right? Yes or no? You have used them. So I could complete the feedback through an op amp. Okay. Which of A and B must be the negative terminal of the op amp for it to be negative feedback? A, obviously. In fact, just now we saw that the because of for negative feedback, we have to have negative incremental gain. So that means that we need to have polarities to be like that. And that I'll just call VD0. This is an ideal op amp. So let's say this is 3 volts and this is 128 microampere. We will consider the usual MOS transistor. Okay. Please evaluate the condition under which the transistor is in saturation. Okay. And also if it's in saturation, find the value of this voltage. Okay. Please do that. Assume that the op amp is ideal. Constraint on saturation region, it's very easy. I mean, you don't have to even calculate anything. I've already told you the drain voltage can go below the gate voltage, but not by more than one threshold. That's the constraint, right? So VD has to be greater than VG minus VT, which you already know this is 2 volts, okay. And if it's in saturation, the current is mu n Cox by 2 W by L VGS minus VT square, and for the given current and the parameters, this will turn out to be 1.6 volt. VGS minus VT will turn out to be 1.6 volt. So this voltage is 3 minus, that's VGS minus VT. So VGS is 2.6 volts and this is 3 minus 2.6 or 0.4 volts. Okay. I mean, this type of calculation is a routine thing that you will have to do with every circuit, right? You will be given component values, you will have to calculate VGS and evaluate whether it's in saturation and so on. Okay. Now, of course, VD has to be greater than 2 volts and this is an ideal op amp and this is a negative feedback, so the op amp input terminals are virtually shorted. So the drain voltage equals VD 0, okay. So now of course you can also take this and turn it into a common source amplifier. It's more cumbersome. First of all, the bias itself looks somewhat complicated and then you have to essentially make the op amp go away and connect the source to a small signal ground and so on. All that is kind of cumbersome. So this is not a preferred way of biasing a common source amplifier, but you could do it if you wish to, okay. What's that? Oh yeah, of course it will be, yeah. So the standard op amp requires at least maybe 7 transistors or something. So, yeah, we'll come to it at the end of the course. There are simpler things that we can use as well. Let me see, we can probably get to that. And now let's look at sensing at the source and feedback to the gate. To sense the difference at the source, I connect a current source to the source terminal. Okay. Now, of course, we know that just making this connection already introduces feedback, right, to the source. But let's ignore that part for now. If ID is more than I0, what would you want to do to VG? If the actual drain current is more than the desired drain current, we have to reduce VGS. Okay? And this would suggest that the gate voltage must also reduce, isn't it? Okay? Yeah. We don't know, so that's why I said let's ignore the feedback to the source voltage for now. But generally, I mean, VGS is VG minus VS, so you try to reduce VG and increase VS. If you do both, I mean, there's no harm. Okay. Then, also, you know that if ID is more than I0, this difference current flows here, ID minus I0, and VS increases. Okay, the source voltage increases, and we want to complete the feedback loop like that. So what should be the property of that block? Again, a negative incremental gain. Okay, so if this has a negative incremental gain, then as VS increases, VG will drop and there will be feedback. But of course, this is slightly different from the other cases. In this case, there is feedback both to the source as well as to the gate, because the moment you connect the current source to the source, there will be feedback. Okay, so it will be there. And as before, we can complete the feedback loop through an op-amp. And the polarity must be like this for negative feedback. And let me call this VS0. If you do have an amplifier between this point and the gate, what happens is the following, that there will be feedback to the source just because you made this connection, and there will be feedback to the gate through the amplifier, but the feedback to the gate will be much stronger because it will go through the amplifier. Okay. So, although this has feedback to both source and gate, the feedback to gate is much stronger. Okay. What is that? Stronger, much stronger. Meaning, let's say this difference ID minus I0 causes some change here, delta V. Okay, whatever it is. Let's say ID is more than I0, the difference flows into the capacitor and the voltage increases by a little bit. Now, what will be the change in voltage over there? If the op amp's gain is A0, it will change by minus delta V times A0, where A0 is a large number. So, what I mean is that the gate voltage changes by a much larger amount compared to the drain voltage. Okay. So this again is used sometimes, but this is again also not suitable for use with a common source amplifier, because you have to essentially make the op-amp go away and connect the source to ground and so on. Okay, but it is useful for some other cases which we will see later. Okay. Any questions so far? So these two are also possible feedback configurations, but the first two are used more often for the common source amplifier. And we don't need to use an op-amp. There are other ways of completing the feedback, which again we will see later. Okay. Let me take any one of these cases. So,
me show only the biasing part. Again, the same MOS transistor. Now, one of the problems when you realize these circuits with discrete components is that you don't have these current sources, or even if you want them, you have to use more transistors. Okay. In case of discrete circuits, I mean, transistors are distinctly more expensive compared to resistors and so on. Okay. So now, there is some motivation to replace this current source with something else, let us say cheaper components. What could we replace it with? I mean, the biasing should be exactly the same, that is the whole idea, right? We still want this 200 microampere current to be flowing through the MOS transistor. But can you substitute one element for another and have all the conditions in the circuit be the same? Have you studied such a result before? Substitution theorem, what does it say? You heard of substitution theorem? Yeah. When did you hear of it? Okay. What does it, what did you hear? Huh? Yes, Manideep, what did you hear? Not what some other element. Can I substitute a resistor with a capacitor? Huh? What does the substitution element say? Substitution theorem say? Substitute what by a resistor? No, I mean, with the original statement of substitution theorem, what was it? What was being substituted by what? Resistor by voltage source or a current source. Okay. So, the original statement of the substitution theorem is that if you have a circuit full of resistors and it can have current sources and so on. Okay. And this resistor could be replaced by a voltage source. But I mean, of what value? You have to actually, I mean, this is valid only for a particular value of the independent sources in the circuit. So, there is some voltage across the resistor, and if you replace the resistor by a voltage source which has the same voltage value, then everything else will remain the same. Okay. And similarly, alternatively, if there is some current here which is IR, you can also replace it with a current source of value IR, and again the solution to the circuit will remain exactly the same. And this is not true just of resistors, you could also replace diodes and other things. Okay. Now, is this what we want to do? What is it we want? I mean, replacing resistor by a current or voltage source, is that what we want? No, what do we want? Replace the current source by, what do you think is a possible candidate? Resistor. Okay. So, you can replace the current source by a resistor. Can you do this? Can you go backwards? Yes or no? Yes. What is the condition? What's that? No, no, that's correct. But can I always do this? What's that? No, no, I know. I know the solution to the circuit. I know all the numbers, let's say. But is there some condition on the original circuit that? Yeah, so that current source must be absorbing power. Okay, if it was a current source that's delivering power, how will you replace it with a resistor? That's, you'll have to replace it with a negative resistance, which is, we don't know how to make that. Okay, replace that. So in this particular case, is it absorbing or delivering power? In this, with these values. Yeah, it depends on Vs. So what is Vs? You do all of that stuff and tell me whether it's absorbing or delivering power. I've given all the values here, right? Absorbing, how much is it? What's the voltage across it? 1 volt, okay. So, at the gate we have 4 volts, VGS is 3 volts, so here we have 1 volt. Clearly, VI product, if you take with the passive sign convention, it is 0.2 milliwatts dissipated in the current source. But anyway, so this only says that we don't need to know how much, but as long as it's absorbing power, it can be replaced by a resistor. So what is the resistance value with which I have to replace it by? Yeah, so it has to be, I mean, obviously, it has some voltage across it and some current through it. Okay, the resistor should have exactly the same voltage and the same current. So the resistance value has to be V by I, or 1 volt divided by 200 microamperes. How much is that? 5 kilo ohm. Okay. So you can also do this. This is a poor man's current source. So if you don't want to use current sources, that is, if you don't want to waste transistors to implement current sources, you can implement them with resistors. Okay. Will everything be exactly the same as before? That's correct. So it's clearly not exactly the same. Incrementally, it is not an open circuit, whereas the other one is an open circuit. And actually, the main reason to go to current source, what was it? Why did we start biasing transistors using current sources? To have a fixed drain current. Okay. So for instance, now, let's say this 24 volts becomes 25 volts. There are many other changes you can consider. What happens to the current in the MOS transistor? Will it remain exactly the same? Why do you say no? So clearly, this 4 volts will become something, 4 times 25 by 24. Now, this voltage will also rise, and finally it will settle to some value, and this current will be more than 200 microamperes. Whereas, if you did have a current source, then regardless of the VDD value, you would only have 200 microamperes. So this will be more sensitive compared to using a current source. At the same time, it will be still better than using a voltage, fixed voltage biasing. Okay. So that's why we do use it many times. This will change, but you can calculate how much it will change, and it will be less. Any questions about this? So that completes the four ways of biasing the MOS transistor at a constant current. You can sense at the drain and feed back to the gate, and that circuit that we used, used is that. But in general, in place of that, you could use anything that has a positive incremental gain, that will work. And yes, that's correct. It's not constant current. It is more constant than a fixed voltage bias. Okay, so you can actually, in fact, you can take this as an exercise and do it. I'll make a small modification to what I showed earlier. Okay. Let's say this is 8 volts. All the same transistor, same parameter I've been considering. So let's say I want 200 microamperes current through the MOS transistor. What is the gate source voltage value? For 200 microamperes, 3 volts. So I need 3 volts here, there, and there. Okay. So in this case, I have just used a voltage source. Okay. I mean, this looks fancy, but this is just fixed VGS biasing, right? I mean, I have 8 volts here and then some voltage drop. So what is this voltage source value for this to be 3 volts? 5, obviously. What is this current source value? What should it be for this to be 3 volts? 200 microamperes. Okay, and what is this resistance value for this to be 3 volts? 5 by 0.2 milliamps or 25 kilo ohms. Okay, so now let's say you have 8 volts plus delta V. Okay, that is, that voltage changes. Now this was 200 microamperes, and with this change it will become plus delta I. cases, right? 200 microamperes plus delta I, let's say delta I1, delta I2, and in this case 200 microamperes plus delta I3. Okay. So, what are delta I1, delta I2, delta I3? Can you tell? How will you evaluate this first? What method will you use? First of all, you can just assume a new value of voltage, let's say 8.5 volts, and do the nonlinear calculations also. But the smart thing to do is what? I mean, we have the operating point and we have some extra. So, what is the right thing to do here? Incremental analysis. So, if you do the incremental analysis, you can find the incremental currents alone, right? So, you can find delta I1, delta I2, and delta I3, and you can see for yourself which is small, which is big, and so on. Okay. If I do calculate the incremental equivalents, what will I get? What do you think? What is delta I2? Zero. Are you sure? Why? How does it come out of the incremental circuit? That's an open circuit. Obviously, delta V doesn't even reach the transistor. Okay. And what is delta I3? You please calculate delta I1 and delta I3. Okay. Please put down the incremental circuit and calculate delta I1 and delta I3. Delta I2 we already know is 0. Okay.